Welcome everybody to this virtual NetGlow presentation. In this presentation, I'm going to present results using a recent automated tool for mapping Twitter data. In particular, it is sort of social semantic tree mode networks, and the focus of the cases are food crisis debates in the Netherlands. So as background, this tool is actor network theory, so Calonne and Calonne and Latour in science and technology studies, who proposed that there could be human and non-human actant networks. So what we've been doing is to expand this idea of that was originally as mapping science and technology studies and the development of, for example, scientific fields. So we expand this idea to public debates on social issues and using social media data, in particular Twitter data, for this analysis. So this approach and tool combines social networks of actors and topical networks of their communications. So in this presentation, the focus is more on the tool side than theory building. So the overall focus is automated analysis of tree mode social semantic networks using indeed Twitter data. So the main question is how to automate the mapping of public debates around social issues in a way that it includes both the social networks of actors, but also content of their communications, so what they are talking about in those social networks. So basically what we did is we extracted from the Twitter data or tweets the hashtags and the addressed usernames. So social actors can address others on Twitter using that at username construction. So we can automatically extract hashtags and the usernames from the networks or from the tweets. Yeah, and in that sense, it results in so-called two-mode actant networks. But in addition to that, of course, the tweets are also authored by individuals, so social actors. And by taking into account also who is the author of the tweet, and not only the content of the tweets where the hashtags and the usernames are used, one can build what could be called tree-mode actant networks. So the approach, what we did, indeed, consists of these three elements. So the authors, the people who wrote and sent the tweet, and on the other hand, the content of the tweets. So the topics that are represented by the hashtags in this method and the addressed actors in the content of the tweets. So in that sense, one could say that we have the relation between the author and the hashtags used in the tweets would be a social semantic network, while the relation between the hashtags and the addressed actors, so addressed usernames in the tweet content, is in a sense semantic network. But then you could also think of the authors of the tweets and what other actors they are addressing in their tweets as a social network. And in this approach, we combine all three aspects. I'm going to show some networks across three food crisis debates. All took place in the Netherlands. The first case, it's about overfeeding chickens so that there's chicken can be sold in supermarkets with low price, cheap price. And this debate, it's more like the responsible for the problem or issue is the poultry farming, trying to maximize their profits. And this first case of overfed chicken, vleeskip in Dutch language, it resulted also to animal welfare organizations boycotting these overfed chicken products sold in supermarkets. The second case, it's about meat sales, which means that some supermarkets in the Netherlands provided sales with meat in order to attract customers to their supermarket chain. This, of course, also led to campaigning against using meat as a sale product. And it does, in this second case of meat sales, it's mostly held that the supermarkets who are doing that are held responsible for this problem or issue. The third case is a crisis that took place in the Netherlands in 2017 in the summer, that there were eggs sold in supermarkets that were contaminated with a pesticide fipronil. This fipronil was used for treating chicken diseases, but it ended up in the eggs. And in this case, it led to withdrawal of and destroying a lot of eggs in the Netherlands. So eggs that were contaminated with this fipronil that also has some health hazards for humans and for human consumption. Okay, our data, as I said, we coded the authors of the tweets to stakeholder groups in a sense that we went and took a look at the authors' site. How do they present themselves? Are they members of media, for example, individual journalists or even big broadcasting companies, or whether they were citizens? And the citizens category, it meant that for example, the Twitter author presented him or herself as an individual citizen, for example, as a mother or father or daughter or that kind of things, without identifying at the workplace or any organizational link. Environmental organizations cover animal welfare organizations in these three cases mainly, but also they could be something like Greenpeace or Friends of the Earth. With conventional industry, we mean mass production of food, yeah, farming industry. With eco industry, those were accounts where they identified themselves as ecological farming. So we coded these different types of stakeholders for the authors. And from the tweet content, we extracted the hashtags and usernames. For the network analysis, we used hashtags and usernames that were used 5 times or more often in the whole debate. This, of course, the threshold could have been, for example, 3 times or more. But that was just a practical decision to keep the network's visualizations readable. Okay, in the first case, over that chicken, we also mapped the authors, how many tweets did each of the stakeholder groups or the author group send during our analysis period? That was 2 years for the overfed chicken case. Well, what we see is citizens, so people who don't identify themselves as part of any typical organization, but as individuals, were very active in this debate. The second very active participating group of stakeholders was media. There was also quite big amount of tweets authored by what we categorized as other, because there are also Twitter accounts where for example, the self-presentation is, for example, a hamster. Now, well, we don't know who that is. So the other category, it consists of Twitter accounts that were difficult to categorize as specific stakeholder group. In the meat sale case, again, one can see that individual citizens participate very actively on Twitter. And again, media as the second most active stakeholder category. Also, this meat sale debate, environmental organizations were quite active. And that's mainly animal welfare organizations in the Netherlands. In the fipronil egg crisis, where we had a shorter time span for the data, because it was one incident of a crisis and not ongoing issue like the overfed chicken and the meat sale cases were. Here, again, citizens were quite active, but the main actor type was media. And also in this egg crisis, also public organizations, which are usually then the healthcare organizations and food authorities, were quite active. Okay, we mapped this all three cases using this automated tool, so that we have the authors of the tweets and the hashtags and the usernames used in the tweet content. What we see here is that the blue cluster, the media part, is they are referring to other also media actors very often. So they're addressing other media and they are using hashtags like news, which is news in English, to tag their tweets as part of news coverage. In the red cluster, however, you can see that citizens and environmental organizations as authors of the tweets use pretty similar hashtags and usernames in their tweets. And also the main hashtag, Bluffkeeper, that means that overfed chicken. What's interesting is here as well is that there are also environmental organizations addressing, for example, McDonald's and other places where overfed chicken products are sold. So not only supermarkets, but also fast food restaurants. In the meat sale debate, again, you can see that citizens authored quite a large number of the tweets. And again, what you see is that media are referring to other media. So they are using hashtags, for example, indeed news, or actuale, which is one type of calling news in Dutch language. While again, environmental organizations and citizens are using similar type of hashtags and usernames in their tweets, and also the main hashtag kiloknaller, which is the meat sale in Dutch. What you saw also in the earlier figure, and here as well, is Vakedir, which is here in turquoise color. That's the main animal welfare organization in the Netherlands. Yeah? So that's positioned between the media and the citizens. Yeah? Okay, then the third case, fipronil contaminated eggs debate. Well, in this case, there were less actors really using hashtags and usernames. But again, what you see is the media as their own cluster, referring to each other. And citizens referring to the main hashtag of the debate, the fipronil. There's also, as a red note, an NVWA, which is the food authorities in the Netherlands. But as you see, environmental organizations were not active in this egg debate. Okay, just summarizing, what I think is remarkable is the similarities, the structural similarities across the three cases. So media organizations seem to use Twitter to refer to each other and form a separate cluster in their hashtag and username use. So it's sort of media bubbles. Yeah? That's interesting for communication sciences to study further that is that the case for other cases as well, or is it something that is typical for food crisis debates on Twitter? Another quite remarkable similarity is that the individual citizens seem to promote the environmental organizations. Yeah. So what we also saw was that citizens were also retweeting tweets originating from these animal welfare organizations. And that was in the overfed chicken and meat sales cases. So overall, media and individual citizens are active to all these three cases. Okay, there are also some differences across the cases. So there are partly different actors participating in these three debates, because the environmental organizations are less active in the egg crisis debate. Of course, that's related to the type of crisis. This egg crisis didn't really attract a lot of attention from animal welfare organizations or initiating any boycotting of eggs. Public organizations, indeed food authorities, were active in the egg crisis debate instead of the environmental organizations. And also the network in the fipronil case looks smaller. That has to do that in that case, fewer unique hashtags and usernames were used overall in the debate. But in order to be able to compare across the three cases, we use the same threshold of 5 or more hashtags or usernames for the analysis. Okay, then in the end, discussion. So these are type of actor networks of societal issues. So this automated method provides these tree mode networks and tree mode network visualizations. But of course, one could also only analyze the social networks of the authors addressing other actors. Or one could only take a look at the usernames and hashtags, so the addressed actors and topics in the content of the feeds. Or indeed also social semantic networks from, for example, authors using specific hashtags. So there are several options how to present the case. Also, one could map also the addressed actors, kind of code those as stakeholder categories. And in that sense, one could perhaps include more hashtags and usernames in the visualizations while still keeping them readable. The one problem or issue for future analysis is that what we now did, we provided a snapshot of the debate. Yeah, so the overfed chicken and meat sales were 2-year-long data sets. Yeah, one could also, of course, take a look sudden moments of change either in the social networks or the semantic networks or the social semantic networks, using, for example, time series analysis or more longitudinal analysis for identifying when did the debate change. I think that would be an addition to actor networks and give more dynamic view. So that leads to the next steps, where, for example, it could be interesting to check the effect of some actor types using less hashtags and addressing less other actors in their tweets. I couldn't identify it with these three cases, but it might be that there are some actor types or categories who systematically use less hashtags and address fewer other actors in their tweets. And that is interesting for how would that affect the network structure. Okay, in this presentation, I focused on three food crisis debates. As next step, I'm also using the tool to map political tweets, and that will be a presentation in virtual Sunbelt, where I took a look at or used dataset of tweets authored by President Trump before he became president and after, to see is the change in the way he addresses other political actors, for example. A further issue is how to measure or use network measures, for example, centrality measures for tree mode networks in this sense, because the nodes in the networks are very different type, yeah? And for sure, when you have that author categories as well added as a third type of node in the networks. So basically, it's calling for further applications of the tool. Thank you.